Okay, and for this final session, after 10 hours on stage, I think I'm going to take a seat to introduce you. Thank you very much to introduce you to my next speaker. And I'm really absolutely super happy to have Nusrat Durrani with us. Nusrat is really a pioneering media executive and a filmmaker. He worked at MTV for more than 20 years. He founded MTV World, the Viacom's visionary global division. And he's the creator of this award-winning Rebel Music and The Music Experiment, which were MTV's first transmedia live music series. And Nusrat, as you may know, has been honored by President Barack Obama himself for his work with native musicians. He has been even called like a wise person, a sage, when it comes to music and pop culture by the founder of MTV. And he's coming, he's here, he's not going to be online. He's here with us all the way from New York. He's a sustainable person. He's not coming only for us. He has billions of meetings here all over Europe in the next days and in the past days. But I'm very honored that he accepted the invitation. And I'm really looking forward to this conversation with Nusrat, and obviously also, I know he has news to say. So welcome on stage, Nusrat Durrani. It's so good to see you again, Nusrat. Last time was, we were together at the Cannes Film Festival, right? Because it was all about music.
Exactly.
I had this bike accident and I could not open my bottle, and I still cannot open my bottle, so I cannot drink anything.
I'm very happy to see your arm is out of the cast now.
Yeah, exactly. So that's great, and I can hold my iPad with both hands. So we have a fantastic title here, because it sounds so cool. The coming revolution in global pop music. Sounds like, yeah. So tell me a little bit more so that we can, you know, share with them and bring them with us here. What does this mean, and why do we need a revolution?
Well, you know, maybe we shouldn't have called it the coming global music revolution, because I think that revolution's already upon us. I mean, your last conversation was with Sama Abdul Hadi,
yeah,
and who I love and adore, and I think she's fantastic. The problem's been that, you know, in the, I guess, the past many decades, or since forever, pop music really is defined within a Western framework, right? If you ask anybody, what is pop music? You know, the probable answers are, depending on where you are in the West, Billie Eilish, Ed Sheeran, I don't know, Jay-Z, Beyonce, Charlie XCX, Lady Gaga, whatever. Any number of names will pop up. In Germany, maybe years ago, somebody would have said Kraftwerk or Daft Punk from France. But the point I'm making here is that it's really, pop music is defined within through a very Western lens. And I happened to work for 2 decades for a company that made that possible. And, you know, we exported American pop culture in the same way that we exported American ideas, American technology, American brands, so that, you know, anywhere you went in the world, I grew up in India, you know, and I knew Madonna, and I knew Michael Jackson, and David Bowie, and Bob Dylan, and Joan Baez. But the shocking thing was that when I came to the U.S. in 1995 to work for MTV, I asked people if they knew anything about music from my part of the world. And the sad truth is that nobody knew what I was talking about. My point is that I think until this point, we have assumed that Western pop music is the default pop music of the world.
Is pop music.
It's pop music. When you say pop music, it's just immediately through the Western lens. And nothing could be further from the truth. Nothing. Why do I say this? This music has been made in the rest of the world throughout the beginning of time. You know, it originated elsewhere. And we have just chosen to let the American and Western mindset dominate the music industry, as it has other industries. Storytelling is a good one. So there is amazing music being made everywhere in the world, and some of the best music, most exciting music, is actually not being made in the US. And by the way, I don't mean this in a sort of you know, a negative way, because there are amazing artists everywhere in the world. Some of my biggest heroes are American and British and et cetera. But that doesn't mean that music from the rest of the world cannot be shared by all of us. So the notion, though, of the coming revolution is because it used to be that it was okay that the world didn't hear what was happening in Africa or in India or, you know, the Middle East. It was okay because the means for distribution of music were very limited. You know, we were pumping versions of MTV through satellite TV. We were basically target bombing, you know, other countries with our stuff. And there wasn't good technology for a reverse flow of pop music because it was all satellite. But with the advent of digital media and social media, now the world is talking to itself. And there's no reason why we shouldn't be sharing music that is made elsewhere. But that's not even the reason. The reason really is business. If you are a major brand in the world, playing in the space of music, you will have to do business to business with the rest of the world. And you cannot do that just by regurgitating Western pop music tropes.
Okay, so it's interesting because I'm thinking we just had, or we still are, in a pandemic time, and a lot of people have been listening to music also, especially last year, and they have been discovering new voices, so that the charts have been changing. If you had a look at the, at least in the streaming platforms, and you can mm-hmm. see that new voices have been, fresh new music has been discovered. So maybe you can tell me a little bit more about this. Do you think that the pandemic also has helped to discover new voices, mm-hmm. new sounds, new music?
Certainly, but I think it depends on how adventurous you are. And I think if media has lobotomized you for decades into only seeking music from a certain part of the world or certain parts of the world, you don't know that there's psychedelic rock being made in Niger in West Africa, or that there's extreme music being made in Indonesia, then it's up to you as an individual to go seek out, you know, the cool new stuff.
You
right?
cannot. I don't think you can count with the algorithm to bring you there, right?
And the algorithm, and that's also a very sad truth of our times, is that we let algorithms do the work that music curators or storytellers used to do. Mm. I use Spotify as a utility. I don't really use it even because I don't want machines to tell me what's cool, you know? Mm-hmm. Because that's not the music experience. But going back to your point, I think, yes, the pandemic did help in music discovery and storytelling discovery because we were consuming a lot of content. But it wasn't as if there was a seismic philosophical shift in the mindsets of people making decisions around music distribution to actually feature amazing music from the rest of the world for the global audiences to consume. You know, that didn't happen. And it hasn't happened in the past because of four or five reasons. Incumbency. American pop culture is global pop culture, and that's just how it is. Laziness, which means that it takes work to actually structure, develop, promote, position artists from other places to be introduced to the rest of the world. And then arrogance, the arrogance that, again, American pop music is the pop music of the world. That's all you should listen to. All that has to change and is changing. And so, yes and no to your question.
Okay. I take both. But now let us dig a little bit more into like what kind of music are we actually talking about?
And this is where I think it's the feast that you must partake of. I mean, everyone in this audience here and anyone watching online should make themselves ambassadors of music from the rest of the world. So I'll give you some examples. Some of the most exciting music is being made in West Africa. And West Africa is Niger, it's Nigeria, it's Senegal, it's Mali. It's always been the case. I mean, some of the greatest musicians ever lived have come from those places. But right this minute in Niger, which is a very tiny country, is producing the most exciting music. And it's not Tende and Bambara only, which is like the traditional musics of that area. It's not just old men playing ethnic music. It's pop music that's bursting at the seams. It's electric, it's immediate, it's urgent, and its craftsmanship and artisanship is mind-blowing. That's just one example. And I think we should play a clip that I just put together very hastily about music from West Africa.
Yes. Can we have the clip?
The first one, please.
We have it. Can we have it loud? Like loud, loud?
In this clip, you're seeing just a handful of artists, and that's Bambino and Madame Actor, who is arguably one of the greatest living guitar players in the world. And Lifildi Iligadad, the girls of Iligadad, who are from a small little village on the border of Mali, playing amazing, amazing blues guitar that is steeped in centuries of tradition. And this music is ready to meet the world. I mean, I'm just telling you, this is one corner of the rich and amazing continent that is Africa. If you go to Nigeria, there's a hip-hop scene and an R&B scene there that is extremely beautiful and producing superstars. Burna Boy, Davido, Tiwa Savage. I mean, I could go on and on. There's an EDM scene in South Africa that's it's incredible. Africa is a whole undiscovered continent. And the thing is that Western artists have gone there and mined the influences and created music inspired by those folks, but never really brought those folks on stage with them and never gave them the platform that they actually really deserve. I'm only talking about Africa. You can go to a country like Indonesia, for instance, which is predominantly Muslim country, and the best extreme music is being made in Africa, be it metal or punk or hip hop. Some of it is being played by hijab wearing young Muslim girls. And you ask yourself the question, how did it come to be that all this crazy heavy music is being made by these conservative women? It's not supposed to be the case. Mm-hmm. But one of the things keeping Indonesia real right now is the fact that there is a heavy metal, heavy music scene there.
Mm-hmm.
Sufi music being made in the part of the world I grew up in, whether it's Pakistan or India. And these are, again, not old bearded men singing polite music. This is music that is ripping the seams apart.
Mm-hmm.
Narco corridos, the music of the southern U.S. border, mm-hmm. the drug ballads that are happening in that part of the world.
Sorry, may I ask for silence? We can hear all the discussions upstairs. Thank you very much. Sorry.
No, that's okay. And then, of course, there is the music that Sama Abdul Hadi represents, which is the music of exile. And that's very interesting because there are 82 million displaced people in the world, 82 million, that's a lot of people. When you leave home, you maybe leave your possessions, your house, your belongings behind, but you actually carry your music with you. And people like Sama Abdul Hadi represent a kind of music. She, of course, is an electronic and an EDM artist. But there are many, which are large groups of refugees that have traveled from one place to another. And they are making music that is incredible, vibrant, and urgent. And I'll give you some examples. Omar Soleiman, he is a dubke singer from Syria. He left Syria in 2011, now lives in Turkey, and is making electronic dubke. And you should seek out Omar Soleiman because your life will change forever. I'm genuinely
mean. This is on music curator of Most Wanted
genuinely,
Music. Yes.
I genuinely mean that. If you haven't heard Omar Soleiman, then you haven't really lived. Or Emmanuel Jal from South Sudan, who was a child soldier and now lives in Canada, but his story is phenomenal, his music is phenomenal. Or a band like La Vida Bohem from Venezuela, who is now in exile in Mexico. This is the music of our times, because these folks, these musicians, are not just fantastic musicians, but they are also telling a story of our time that is urgent and important. And we have chosen not to give these people so far a platform, which I think is it's a tragedy.
Exactly, and I'm talking about platforms. Why should platforms like Apple, Spotify, even Netflix, or what should platforms, streaming platforms, should care about this?
Well, I guess if God was listening to us, then God's answer would be they should do it because it's the right thing. But we're not, businesses don't run on doing the right thing. The reason why all of these companies should care now, and it goes back to the point we were making about the coming revolution, is because all of the growth in business that is happening with Netflix is coming from outside the US and even outside of the Western world. The growth markets for Spotify, Apple, Netflix, any one of these big media streaming companies, even YouTube, is coming from Asia, India, specifically Indonesia, the big Asian countries. It's coming from the Middle East. It's coming from Africa and Latin America. And if you want to do business with these people, with these audiences, you cannot keep streaming Ed Sheeran and Billie Eilish to them. They will need to see their stories on these platforms, and they will need to hear their music mm-hmm. on these platforms mm-hmm. in an authentic, genuine, beautiful way.
I think you brought another clip, short clip. So do we want to watch this?
Yes, the clip I brought is actually unrelated to the countries. It has to do with another country that is forming, another universe that is forming, which is the metaverse.
Okay.
And, I mean, of course, we all know what the metaverse is, but the metaverse is a very interesting place, which I think is going to lead the conversation in the music business for, I would say, in the next 5 years. And obviously, the metaverse is the 3D internet, it's virtual reality, it's gaming platforms, et cetera, et cetera. A lot of mainstream artists, going back to your point about COVID, a lot of mainstream artists didn't have physical venues to perform in. So the innovative ones migrated to the metaverse, to gaming platforms specifically. And last year's big success stories didn't come from real live music. It came from Travis Scott performing on Fortnite for 5 nights, generating millions of audience views and generating millions of dollars in revenue. Lil Nas X, Charlie XCX. So there's a whole kind, there's a music migration almost, both mainstream artists and kids making music in bedrooms on PCs that exists in this fascinating place. And that's the music of the metaverse. And I think that's the clip I want to show. Please play it loudly. Music should be heard loud, I think, you know, not politely.
I'm with you. Baby, lately, I know you think my new friends changed me, but I know either way that you would detest me. There's a couple hundred people wanna hurt me. If you ever need a thing, promise you'll text me. They wanna put a hundred shots into my chest. Please defend me, detest me. There's a
is interesting because you can be whoever you want, and there are lots of things intersecting in this space. One is the notion of actually having a virtual presence, you know, being a virtual performer. But the lower end, or I shouldn't say lower end because it's a condescending word, but like the relatively unknown artists that were making music on their PCs were actually doing it as a sort of defiance. You know, they were defying the traditional industry norms, defying record labels. They didn't want to deal with all the bullshit of the music industry. So an artist like Glaive, for example, he's a 16-year-old boy from North Carolina who's all the rage right now in the metaverse and in real music industry. They just start making this music. Some of them are not even proper singers, but it's a DIY sort of world, and it's a defiance of consumer culture, but also an embrace of it. And so they make this music, and they bypass traditional outlets and go straight to SoundCloud or to YouTube in case of Glaive and TikTok. And suddenly, they have developed audiences in the millions. You're a 16-year-old boy with 29 million followers all over. Then you go to a record industry, the record label, and say, hello, I want to make a new album.
Yes.
And I think you're listened to and heard in a very different way. Yeah. And I love that. Because it's very punk, and I think I think that's one of the movements that I'm inspired by, because I think creators should be calling the shots. You know, we need to surrender control to the young and to the innovative, because that they're the future. You know,
absolutely. So I was mentioning before, we met in Cannes in July. We meet now at the Most Wanted Music. Next time we will meet will be in Tallinn.
Yes.
I will be in Tallinn.
Because my film is premiering.
Yes, and that's why I'm telling you. I will see you and your film is premiering at the Black Nights, the Tallinn Film Festival, on November 21. And the film is called, it's a documentary, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And it's called An American Prayer. And can you tell us a little bit more? I mean, I know it's a bit preview, but you can share a little bit and tell us, because
An American Prayer is a documentary we made in 2020 at the height of the pandemic. I think we were the only film crew actually making a film when not only is the pandemic, people are dying from it, but also racial uprising. You know, the Black Lives Matter movement was happening. Trump was, you know, going batshit crazy. The whole country was exploding, and I felt like I'm living in some sort of parallel universe. And so I react, and you know, I went through a lot of personal crisis because I lost my mom to COVID, and she was in India, and I couldn't attend her funeral. And I was devastated with all that was happening personally and in the country I lived in. So I reacted to it in the way that most artists actually do react to these things, and I made a film about it all. So An American Prayer is a film that examines the state of the American dream through six or seven different characters. And it's a reframing of what is America today. And you know, the America I went to is, migrated to, is unrecognizable to me, because all of the pillars holding up the country seem to have fallen. But it's not a gloomy, sort of hopeless film. I think it's actually a very inspiring film, because the people in it, the six characters in the film, are really transcendent, inspiring, and deeply American characters.
Mm.
And that's what the film is about.
So that's interesting, because we were talking at the very beginning of the conversation, like pop music, American, white pop music most of the time. And I heard that, I mean, please tell me if we can talk already about it, but you are preparing something new also, right? You're preparing like a series?
Yes, indeed. So I had to get An American Prayer out of my system, so it unburdened me to do what I really want to do, which is make amazing, sexy content that, you know, people will dance to.
So it will be about pop music? Or?
Yes, so I'm making a film about all the stuff we've been talking about, which is, it's a series, we're codenaming it, it's not the real name, it's called Soundways, and it's about all the most powerful music movements in the world right now. And it's the each episode is set in a specific country. And each episode is about two or three artists from that particular country and their stories, and their, through them, the stories of the music and the story of that particular country. And so we're covering, we have 10 episodes in the first season. We're covering West Africa. We're covering Hyperpop, which is, you know, the some of the stuff you just saw. You know, we're covering narco corridos. We're going to Indonesia. We're going to, you know, music of exile, many places that, you know, have a lot of refugee populations. And it really is, I think, the soundtrack to the real world we live in. And one thing I want to stress is that this isn't music which is fringe or very esoteric that you couldn't understand and they're like five people in a hovel making music. No, this is music that is joyous and explosive, and it has people dancing, and it's people hungry, and it has people that will move you, grab you by the throat, take you to the dance floor, and make you confront and see the world in all its magic and beauty.
He can pitch, right? I mean, you want to watch this too.
I want to watch this.
I want to watch it. Where will we see this? Do we know it already?
You know, we're going to see it, I hope, in the next, between 12 to 15 months.
Yes. You cannot tell us where right now.
No, I cannot.
But you will next year if you come back here,
next
right?
Time,
yeah, okay.
I will. Next time, I hope I will play the first episode for you.
Yeah. Oh my God. Okay. So this is great. Anyway, I'm following you everywhere: Twitter, Instagram, wherever
Thank you
are. You. So I will know first, and
Thank
I will
you.
Post.
Yes.
I will post. That's for sure. And you can also follow Nusrat for sure. So basically, for my final question, because we're unfortunately, I could go on for 2 hours with you, but we only have 5 minutes left before the get-together. So I just would like to ask you, so is this series actually your contribution, the way you tap into this potential of revolution to make it happen? It's a political statement.
Well,
I mean,
so, you know, I've done this all my life, through my professional career at least. You know, I had MTV, I created MTV World, which was... We were creating music content and storytelling around the world, basically. And this precedes Netflix. We were doing this from 2004. I launched a K-pop channel in America in 2005, and a Bollywood channel, and we brought Norwegian heavy metal into the U.S. and all of that. So it's not, you know, it's not. This isn't new to me, but I think it's really surprising to me that this hasn't been done. It's not rocket science. I mean, we have shows like Chef's Table, which are about food from, you know, and chefs from around the world. I think I'm a conduit. You know, I'm a medium through which this music can travel. And it would be my honor and my pleasure to actually expose the world to some of the most joyous sounds that are being made in the world.
I mean, I can't wait to see this.
You know, this is my world.
This is so good. Listen, I'm so sorry that it is such a short conversation. I really would like to thank you for this. I want to ask, however, to be a bit interactive. Do we have one burning question for Nusrat? I would take it. Otherwise, I would say we leave it at that because it was great. Okay. Well then, thank you so much, Nusrat, to have shared that with us, really. And we will watch, that's for sure. And you are with us a little bit for the get-together now.
Sure,
so
absolutely.
It will be a pleasure to continue the conversation. Thank you.